Welcome. This question says, consider a shape-shifting object that can change its footprint area but not its mass. A student calculates the pressure that the object exerts on the floor for different footprint areas. What should her graph of pressure versus area look like? And then it says, assume appropriate values for the relevant parameters, write the governing equation, make data table, plot complete graph with at least three data points, and all axes must be linear. And there's a framework here for a graph, but there's no real guidance. We know that because it's pressure versus area, this is going to be pressure here, and this is going to be area there. And I assume that's going to be in square meters and a meter square. And then I assume this is going to be in Pascal. So there we go on, and we're trying to get a graph out of this. I've got to put numbers in. Got to visualize it. So you could imagine, well, here's an object that's got a large area, and then take the same object and just redistribute where the area. I mean, if it's the same amount of stuff, then I have the same mass, but I have different areas to think about. And I can say, well, pressure is equal to the force, which in this case will be the weight, divided by the area. And pressure is equal to mg, therefore, divided by the area. And if I look at my axes, I'm plotting pressure and I'm plotting area. So this is a good relationship to look at. Let's highlight that's one axis. And well, let's do one more piece of writing. Pressure is equal to mg times 1 over a. I like to write it like that. And then I see there's one axis, and then there's the other axis, with some stuff in between, and m's constant. I don't know what it is, but it says it can't change, and g's constant. I'm assuming it's on Earth, so it's 10, but it doesn't matter. And then I've got to somehow make a table out of this. So if I think about my table, the problem is people look here now and start thinking about the table when they should be looking here and thinking about the table. And the table is all about pressure and area. And we need at least three data points. So I'm going to look over here and I'm going to say, I don't care what those two guys are. I'm going to assume they equal one. You know, you can have m is 1/10 and g is 10. It doesn't matter. Whatever they are, they're not going to change. So let's just leave them as one. And then I say to myself, well, let's assume that the area was 1 square meter. So that would be a is 1 square meter. So my pressure is 1 over 1, which is 1 pascal. And if my area is 2 square meter, then I have, oh, 1 over 2, 1/2. And if my area is 3 square meters, then my pressure is 1 over 3. And if my area is 4 square meters, then that's 1 over 4. And finally, if my area is 5 square meters, that's 1 over 5. So I want my pressure scale to go from, well, really 0 to 1. So 0, 0.2, 0.4, 0.6, 0.8, 1.0. You know, I'm doing what I tell my students not to do, which is I'm not putting the zeros down because I'm short of space. And that's no excuse. So 0.2, 0. I like to put the zeros in so that you know this is actually a decimal point and not just some little fleck on your page. And this is pressure. And on this side, I'm going to go from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Who told me to do this? Nobody. I told me to do this because I looked at my table. And then I say, well, when this is 1 pascal, this is 1 square meter, so 1 pascal and 1 square meter. That looks like it's there. Let's change colors so it stands out. there. And then when the area is 2, we're at half. So area is 2, we're at 0.5. When the area is 3, we're at 1/3, which is 3 and a third, which will be just about there. When the area is 4, that's going to be 1/4, which is 1.25, which is there. When the area is 5, we're at 0.2, which is a kind of nice, pleasing graph. It's an inverse, of course. And here's the, the sad thing is some people can just look at it and say, oh, it's an inverse, and they can just draw the graph. I used to let people just draw me the trace, but then we'd argue about if they're drawn an inverse or an inverse square. And I realized that people are very uncomfortable when they have to make stuff up for themselves. So it's a good exercise where I give you deliberately very little information to actually work with. You have to decide what's a variable, what's not a variable, and when it's not a variable, when it's a constant, you have to decide what value to give it. You can work this out. You could say my mass is 17 kilograms and I'm on the moon, so G is 1.6. As long as you keep those numbers constant, you will get the right answer. They're not going to stop you from getting the right answer, which is the shape of this curve. You'll have different numbers, but the shape of the curve will be correct. So people are very uncomfortable when you don't give them numbers to chew on, but it's a really useful skill to be able to look at something and be confident enough to know what you can assume and what you can't assume and work with it. So this is a really good skill to have. So there we have it. It's an inverse relationship, and I had at least 3 data points, and I had my table. I did everything. My axes were linear. I did everything that I needed to do to get my